As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Now, that's not Joshua 1:8, I'm sorry. But he does say that in the Bible. Choose you this day, we will serve. Joshua 1:8 is be strong and courageous. All right. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hey, praise God. This is Pastor Mark at the Road Angel Church, welcoming you here for Sunday service today. We want to let you know we appreciate all of you, and we are a trucking ministry here to help the drivers, give them an oasis. We call it an oasis of love, where they come in and we give them free laundry, free parking, free showers, free coffee, free snacks, free food, whatever they need. We're here to help the driver. We're here 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So come on in and see us. We're at exit 68 on I-70. And you just head toward Brownstown and you'll see us right there. We're 70 miles east of St. Louis and 30 miles west of Effingham, where the Big Cross is. And so we appreciate y'all. If you want to get a hold of us, you can email us at Association of Christian Truckers with an S. @gmail.com. Association of Christian Truckers @gmail.com. You can go to our website. That's Road Angel Truckers Center.com. Once again, with the S. Road Angel Truckers Center.com is the website. And you can chat in here on the live stream by going to Association of Christian Truckers on YouTube. And you click on the one that has a red circle around it, because sometimes there's two of them that come up. And you'll be there. So tell your friends, call your friends, tell them, get on the YouTube. We're live, right, Crystal? Yep, get on the YouTube. We're live right now. And we're going to talk about God a little bit. We'll brag on God. Hallelujah. All right. Well, is there any testimonies today of what God's done? Hallelujah. Any testimonies? Did God do anything for anybody today? Hallelujah. This week? This month? Well, I'm going to testify. I'm always going to testify. You know, God got us through. We had a trip to Pennsylvania. Then we had a trip to Florida. God got us through all that. And there was great miracles happened through all those things. And so I just want to thank God. And now next week, Eric and I will be going to the Peoria Truck Show. So we won't be here. But I want to tell you, there will be somebody here because we're here 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. And as we go to Peoria, we're going to talk to a lot of people and tell them about ACT. And God might even get somebody saved there, right, Eric? Hallelujah. So we are ready to go there. We'll be going Thursday, Friday, Saturday. And we'll be back Sunday afternoon. So I got to find somebody to preach, but we'll figure it out. Crystal, you want to preach? No? No, she didn't want it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey, we love you all. We just appreciate you. You know, we're gonna have prayer requests right now. Do we have any prayer requests? I didn't see any out in the box there. We want you to continue praying for Morgan Marie Hewitt, my granddaughter, as she is recovering. She has been dealing with brittle bone disease, and she's had an operation not too long ago, and she's doing well, right, Crystal? She's doing good. She's doing her physical therapy, and we hope that she'll be able to walk here not too long. So keep praying for her, though. We need supernatural healing because there's no cure for this disease. But God. God is our healer, amen? Can I get an amen? Let's check it out. Amen? Got one. Amen? All right. We don't have too many in the house today, so we'll have to imagine the amens, I guess. Praise God. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you for Crystal and for Morgan. Lord, we know that you're the only one that can truly heal her. We thank you that you help her get through this time of rehab and getting her back up where she can walk. And you use the Holy Spirit to keep her from falling. And Lord, I just thank you that the cure for this disease, though, is you. We just put it in your hands in Jesus' name. We pray for every driver out there, Lord God. There's 12,000 a day go by here. We pray for those drivers. We thank you, Lord, that you're watching over them, that you're moving in their lives, in their families, in whatever needs to be taken care of. The Lord says, look to me, drivers. Look to me. Ask me. The Bible says, you have not because you ask not. Ask of me, says God, and I will help you, and I will be there for you. Don't try to do it on your own. You've already tried that. How's that working out for you? God says, I am there for you in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We thank you that you're there in every circumstance, in marriages, in finances, and in health. Lord, we look to the hills from whence comes our help. So we thank you for helping us today, Lord God. We give you the glory in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. All right. Well, I got a little nugget today. Has anybody else got anything to say? Any testimony? Anything you want to add? All right. I got a little nugget. God wants me to go over some things in the book of James with you guys. It's really full of nuggets. It's really worth diving into. James 1, chapter 1, verse 1. It says, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greetings. What did James say? He was a servant of God. Are we a servant of God, or are we a servant of ourselves? It's a very serious question we need to ask. James said, I'm a servant of God. I'm here for you. Hallelujah. Come on in, William. We love you, man. Another driver, another amen. Hallelujah. James is a servant of God. I just started, didn't I? James, he said, I'm a servant of God. I'm there. I'm a servant of God, Eric. You're a servant of God. You proved it by what you do. You didn't really have to tell anybody, but you can tell by what you do. You know? The Bible says that you'll know them by their fruit. If we have good fruit, if we're helping people and we're sharing the word of God with people and we're bringing them to Christ, that's good fruit. Amen. Amen. James, the servant of God, to the 12 tribes that are scattered abroad, greeting. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations. I always used to say that's diverse temptations. No, not divers. Hallelujah. Count it all joy when you fall into temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith works patience. Every trial we go through works patience. Can I get an amen? Amen. Man, I've been through a lot of trials. I bet all of you have. And every time you get through there, the Bible says God works all things together for good for you. If you love him, how many love God? I can show hands, love God. Hallelujah. And are called according to his purpose. Well, I'm not called, Mark. I'm not a preacher. I'm not a singer. No, you're called. If you're a Christian, you are called. You are called to preach the good news to every creature. That means you tell somebody. There's a song. Who wrote that song? It says, I got to tell somebody. I got to tell somebody about what God's done for me. You know, people need to hear. They need to see. They need to know it's real. You know, they say, well, I hear all this stuff about Jesus, and I hear all this thing about miracles. I need to know it's real. Can you tell me it's real, Bill? Yeah, you bet you can.
Amen.
Amen. It's real. I was going in the hospital. The doctors told my wife there's no way to save him. He's sepsis. He's got so much infection in him, he's going to die. But God, God appeared to me, not, I didn't see him, but I heard him in a vision, and he said, you can stay or you can go. He gave me a choice. I said, what do you want me to do, Lord? He said, I got more work for you to do. I said, let's get her done. So 54 days in the hospital, telling me every way I was going to die. And I kept saying, I'll live and not die to declare the works of the Lord. See, you got to have that word of God in you. You got to be able to say it. It's got to come out of you. I said, I'll live and not die to declare the works of the Lord, which is the Bible verse. And everything, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. Well, I got through all that. I got healed in the hospital several times. Why? Because God is God. You want to know if it's real? I'm standing here 7 years later, praising and preaching and helping people get to know God better. He's real. Went into a full jackknife. God pulled it out. There's so many, I can tell, I'm going to write a book because I've got a lot of stories. And I want to tell somebody, amen? That didn't go so good. Amen? Amen. There, I got my one guy. If I get my one guy, I'm doing good. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall. Count it joy. Oh, you know what I do now? I'll tell you what, when I see something coming, I say, you know what? I say, devil, bring it on. Because all you're going to do is give me another testimony where I can stick you and push you down, because God is going to see me through this trial. Amen? Amen. Catch it head on. Put on the full armor of God, the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness. Have your loins girded about with the truth. Read the word. Get it in you. Have your feet shod with the preparation of peace. Glory to God. Have the shield of faith and the sword of the Spirit. Be ready for battle. This is a war. Devil's not going to let you just sit there. He's going to try. But he's a loser. And you have more authority than he has. If you know Jesus Christ and you have a relationship with him, an intertwining relationship. Not just, oh, yeah, I know there's a Jesus, or, yeah, I think Jesus is all right. I think he's a good guy. He's been son. Jesus is just all right by me. Jesus is just all right. Oh, yeah. He's more than all right by me. Hallelujah. Knowing this, that the trying of your faith works patience. But let patience have her perfect work, that you might be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God. That's not there by coincidence. God's saying the way out of the trial is what? Asking him for wisdom. There's another verse that says, you have not because you ask not. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, that gives to all men. Everybody say all. All men. How many men does that mean? All. So he doesn't just give wisdom to Pastor Mark or Brother Phil or Pastor Phil. He gives wisdom to all men liberally. He's ready to give you wisdom liberally. Don't think God's too far off. Lord, in the name of Jesus, you come to God in the name of Jesus, because Jesus was the sacrifice for all your sin. And when you come to him in the name of Jesus, he looks at you as perfect. And you say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I'm asking. Amen? So when you get into trials and temptations, what do? Ask God. God, what do I do here? The three Hebrew children were in a fiery furnace that was so hot, it killed the soldiers that put them in there, but they were in there dancing. They were in there with Jesus. There was four of them in there. And the king looked down in that furnace. They used to be in a pit on the ground. He looked down there and he said, didn't we put three men in the fire? And they said, yeah. He said, well, there's a fourth man in there, and he looks like the Son of God. How would he know what the Son of God looked like? That's questions I have. But he said, hey, come out of there. See, he still had to be the king. He goes, hey, come out of there. So they're in a trial, man. They're in the middle of the fire. But you know what they said before they went in the fire? The king said, is your God able to deliver you? And they said, our God is well able to deliver us. But even if he doesn't, we're not bowing to you. So when they went into that fire, they put everything in God's hands. They laid it all in God's hands. They said, all right, we're going in the fire. Now, don't you think that they knew that that fire was that hot? They knew. See, they made the king mad when they told him they wouldn't bow to him. He made the fire 7 times hotter. I'll show you. God says, no, I'll show you. So he was so impressed that they came out of the fire, and the Bible says there was no smell of smoke on them at all, that he gave them higher positions in the government than they had before. And he told all the people, listen to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, because their God is the true God. See, they came out better than they did when they went in. They were perfected by the fire. If any of you ask, any of you lack wisdom, how many lacks wisdom here? Ask of God that gives to all men liberally, and upbraideth not, and it shall be given to him. He's not going to say, oh, you stupid Christian, I don't know why you don't know this. It's not what God's going to do. He's going to give to you liberally. Lord, I need wisdom. Boom. All of a sudden, you're going to understand things. You're going to understand things that you did in your past, that you've done up to now. You're going to say, oh, I see how I got here. And then God's going to show you what to do about it. He's not going to make you feel guilty. He's just going to say, okay, here's how you got here. Now, here's how you get out of it. Because the devil's going to keep coming. He's going to keep tempting you. He's going to keep putting you in trials. So you got to know how to get out, how to be a good soldier, how to, when you fall down, get back up and keep on shooting. If you lay there, the enemy's going to walk up and shoot you. No, you get right back up. I'm saved. I'm redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I made a mistake. I sinned. Okay, I repent. Thank you, Father. Now I'm right back where I was. Just as powerful as I ever was. That's got to be your thinking. You have to know that God delivers you completely. But let him ask in faith, nothing wavering. They said, no matter what, King, we're not bowing to you. Our God's well able to deliver us. See, that's not wavering faith. For he that wavereth is like a wave of the sea, driven with the wind and tossed. See, you got to have faith. Now, see, a lot of people have hope. I'll say, do you know Jesus? And I'll say, well, I hope so. The Bible says hope is the beginning of faith. But it's not faith. Faith says, yes, I know Jesus, even though I can't see him. Yes, I know God, even though I can't see him. That's faith. For let not that man, the guy that wavers, think that he'll receive anything of the Lord. You can't receive anything of the Lord unless you act in faith. The Bible says without faith, it's impossible to please God. See, the whole thing revolves on you going to John 3:16 and saying, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever shall believeth in him shall have eternal life, not might or could, but shall. But you got to believe it. You got to have faith. Can I get an amen? Amens make me go faster. So, you know. Like my pastor say, amen, owe me something. Let not that man think he'll receive anything of the Lord. A double-minded man, everybody say double-minded man, is unstable in all his ways. All his ways. Well, I hope God delivers us. I'll give you an example here. Well, I'm $20,000 in the hole. Well, I don't know if God's going to deliver us. Well, I'm not sure if God's going to deliver us. I mean, God might deliver us. I hope he does. He's done it before. I'm not going to receive anything. I have to say, this is your ministry, God. I understand where we're at, but you're going to deliver us in Jesus' name. And guess what? God delivered us. When it looks impossible, that's when it's the best time, because God says, I make a way where there seems to be no way. Amen. Let the brother of low degree rejoice in that he is exalted. What's that mean? The brother of low degree. You might think you're the lowest guy on the totem pole, but guess what? God exalts you. If you're a child of the living God and you're getting fruit and you're doing what God's shown you to do, he'll exalt you. But the rich in that he has made low, rejoice. If you're rich and you're made low, if you're rich and you start losing stuff, because as the flower of the grass, he shall pass away. For the sun is no sooner risen with a burning heat, but it withers the grass and the flowers thereof fall, and the grace of the fashion of it perishes. So also shall the rich man fade away in his ways. If you're a rich man and all you're thinking about is money, you're going to fade away. You're not going to get to heaven. You can give away as much. Well, I gave all this money to charity. Yeah, but you didn't know Jesus. You didn't know Jesus. You gave it to this one, that one, the other one, but you didn't give it to any churches or anybody that's furthering the gospel of Jesus Christ. Just saying, blessed is the man that endures temptation. We're talking a lot about temptation and trials today, aren't we? We go through them all the time. But blessed is the man that endures, that gets through the trial. I'm blessed. I got through the 54 days in the hospital and the follow-ups and the checkups and all that stuff. I endured. Why? Because I love God. I knew that God was for me, so nobody could be against me. I knew there was a purpose in what I was doing. I saw people in the hospital that came to the light of Jesus Christ because I was in there. And I was able to pray with them. I saw people in my church because I was in the hospital, but I was live streaming on my computer to our meetings. They saw that faith. They saw that I didn't let that stop me from serving God. Now, it's not about me. God gives me the strength to do that. What I'm trying to say is, I endure. Blessed is the man that endures temptation, for when he has tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which God has promised to them that love him. I want that crown of life. That's the crown I want. Well, that's perfect. I don't go through anything. Everything's fine. Look out. I warn you. If you're not being tried, there's something wrong. I'm not saying you got to be in trouble all the time, but I'm saying the devil's going to try you. And when you get up there and start saying, oh, everything's great, I'm good, I'm no matter, that's pride. And pride goes before a fall. Temptation. Temptation. Here's an important verse right here. If you get this, you'll understand everything. Let no man say when he is tempted, I am tempted of God. I don't want to hear somebody tell me, well, God put that trial on me. He did not. He does not tempt you. It's very clear here. But neither tempteth he any man. God can't be tempted with evil. He ain't having nothing to do with evil. He's not using evil to tempt you. But every man is tempted when he is drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Well, there's a lot of wickedness in us. But Jesus comes in and he suppresses all that, and he shows you, you're in a continual learning process and how to get rid of some of that stuff, right? But it's still in there. The devil brings up, and you're enticed. Well, God will forgive me. I can just do this one time. Wrong attitude. Because once you do it one time, you'll get pulled back into it 100 times. But who is the one that causes it? You do. You choose. Choose you this day who you will serve. God, I'm really tempted to go drinking. I really want to go drinking. I want to go see my buddies down at the bar. I want to go drinking. But when you endure that temptation, you say, no. I'm a child of the living God. Drinking has never done anything but destroy my life. I'm not going to go there. You endure that temptation. Lust, you're not going to have me. I don't care. Change your thinking. That girl's really hot. I wish I could counsel her in Jesus' name. Help her come to Jesus Christ. Help her to understand the Bible. See, I took that thought captive. I said, no, you have to change that. Right? The Bible, there's another verse that says, taking every thought captive to the obedience of Christ, the anointed Jesus, the anointed. I don't care what thought it is. If you will take it to God, ask, right? Have not because you ask not. Lord, help me with this. I ask. God's going to give you a way of escape. Do not, see, when lust has conceived, it brings forth sin. And sin, when it is finished, brings forth death. All sin is death. Therefore, let's not go out and try to sin. Let's not go succumb to it. When we see it, let's change our stinking thinking. Let's turn it around. Take every thought captive. I'm thinking about so-and-so. Nope. You know what, Lord? I'm going to change that thought. I'm going to take that captive. That's not me anymore. That's not what I do. That's not what I am. I'm going to pray for that person. That's what I'm going to do. Am I making any sense? Am I getting through to anybody? Guess not. I know I am online. We got some people on YouTube. When lust is conceived, it brings forth sin. When it's finished, it brings death. Every good gift, everybody say every good gift, every perfect gift, say it, is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights, with whom is no variableness, neither no shadow of turning. Every good gift comes from God, who doesn't change. He says, I change not. I'm the same yesterday, today, and forever. I'm giving good gifts. I'm not making you sick. I'm not tempting you. I am giving you good gifts. You've heard people, well, God made me sick to teach me a lesson. No, he did not. The devil made you sick. And you let him. Because you didn't stand up to him. Well, I mean, don't you just go to the doctor? Well, somebody that doesn't know Jesus, that's what they do. But if you know Jesus, you might say, Lord, in the name of Jesus, I come against this sickness, against this disease. I command it to stay away from me. I command, you know, when there's one area I'm really good in, and some other areas I'm not. One area I'm good in is a cold. When a cold starts, when I hear the first symptom in my throat, when I get the first sniffle, I say, you don't have any authority here. I'm not playing this flu season. I'm on the bench. You have to go in Jesus' name, and it does. Now, I have some other things that I've dealt with for a long time, like diabetes. And I've prayed that way, and I've prayed and prayed and prayed. Guess what, though? He who endures temptation, right? I'm enduring it. I'm healed. I don't care what it looks like. I'm enduring it to the end. Can you get a grasp of that? Hallelujah. There's more things I'm learning. But God's not trying to teach me a lesson. What he wants me to do is learn how to stand against these things. He wants me to learn how to get out of it by using his word. Yeah, don't be in error, my brethren, because every good thing comes from God. He's telling you this very thing. Don't say God put it on you. He didn't. unless it's a good gift. Everybody got that? Let's just cut that off in the bud right now. Well, God made me sick. That taught me a lesson. No, God did not make you sick. But God is in it with you, and he'll help you get out of it. And when I went in that hospital, he was right there, and he said, you got a choice. You can come home, be with me, or you can keep stay here. And I said, what do you got? I got more work for you. All right, let's get her done. That's exactly what I said. And here I am doing more work, right? Hallelujah! That only happened because of God. It didn't happen because of me, with the exception that I believed him. Of his own will begat he us. God created us out of his own will with the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. He made man to be different, to be his companion, to be like him. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, slow to wrath. I could spend an hour on that right there. Swift, slow to speak. I knew an older gentleman in the VFW, and he used to always say to me, Mark, if everybody would take 10 seconds before they speak, it would change the world. I believe that's true. For the wrath of man works not the righteousness of God. When you're mad, you're not working the righteousness of God. Can I get an amen? Got you on that one a little bit. Wherefore, lay apart all, everybody say all filthiness and superfluity, I can't say that right, and the engrafted word which is able to save your souls, a superfluity of naughtiness, and receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save your souls. By his stripes I am healed. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. I get these words in my heart, so that's what comes out. When I'm faced with anything, the first thing I say is, no weapon formed against me will prosper. I don't care what you got in mind, devil, it's not going to prosper. I'll live and not die to declare the works of the Lord. For if any be a hearer of the word and not a doer, oh, wait a minute, hold on, I skipped one. 22, but be ye doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving your own selves. Well, that was a wonderful message Pastor Mark gave. And I feel really good, so I'm just going to go home. Are you going to do any of it? Or did you just hear it? Are you going to do any of it? I'm believing some of you are. For if any is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he's like unto a man beholding his natural face in a glass. For he beholds himself and he goes his way, and straightway he forgets what manner of man he was. I heard the word and it got revealed to me, and I saw myself in that mirror. I saw myself that I got to put away some filthiness and some nastiness and some things. And I saw it, but when I walked away, I forgot all about it. I forgot who that man was. But whoso looks into the perfect law of liberty and continueth therein, he being not a forgetful hearer, but a doer of the work, this man shall be blessed in his deed. Take this word that I'm giving you today. Go back over it. Listen to the recording. Go on YouTube and listen and say, how does that apply to me? Maybe there's some things that I need to change in my life. Maybe there's some things that I'm doing. It's my lust. It's my problem. And God is there to help me if I just ask. If any man among you seem to be religious and he bridleth not his tongue, but deceives his own heart, this man's religion is in vain. If you're religious and you can't control what you say, you see, sin keeps getting refined as you grow. And maybe you don't chew, or you don't spit, or you don't kick the cat, and you don't cuss. But maybe, just maybe, you couldn't bridle your tongue. Somebody said something and you jumped right off. See, my religion's in vain if I do that. You know how little a mistake it takes to ruin ministries? I get accused of a lot of things here, believe me. I heard another one yesterday. And I was like, well, you know me better than that. You know that's not even possible. Yeah, I knew that, but I wanted to check. I thought, why'd you want to check? You'll hear a lot of things. This scripture is used and misused a lot. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this: to visit the fatherless and the widows in their afflictions, and to keep himself unspotted from the world. What's that saying? It's saying to help people when they're in their afflictions before God. And keep yourself unspotted from the world. There's two kingdoms. There's the kingdom of God and the kingdom of this world. Where is the kingdom of God, Eric? And so the Bible says the kingdom of God is in you. The kingdom of God is in you. When you do whatever you do it before God. If you're a Christian, you claim to be a son of the living God, one of the sons, not the son, but a son that represents his father. If you claim that, and then you go out and you just do all kinds of crappy things, what's that do? It ruins your witness. But true religion, people talk about religion all the time. Well, I got my own religion. Okay, so did the devil. That's what he did. He said, I'll make myself above the Most High God. How'd that work out for him? Crashed to earth. No. True religion is putting yourself out there for people. Living your life. We live our lives here. This is our life. We lay down our life for truck drivers. Our entertainment is going to Walmart. I'm not bragging. I'm just telling you what God did. That's what God has done in our lives. That's true religion. But to keep yourself unspotted from the world is the thing. Well, it's okay if I do this. It's okay if I do that. If you're trying to justify it, it's not okay. Amen? Just face it. You know? Well, it's okay if I go have a few drinks with my buddies. Well, you can't do that because you won't do it. You'll have a few and you'll have a few more. And then you'll think about doing something else with somebody else and whatever. It just doesn't work that way. Buddy, I know. I was a full-blown alcoholic, used to be in the bars all the time. I will tell you that you cannot just do that. Unless God has called you aside to do that. And go in there and have a Diet Coke while everybody else is drinking. And tell them about Jesus while you're in there. Oh, Jesus was down with the winebibbers and thieves. That's who he hung out with. And guess what he was doing? He was telling them about him. Tell them about his holiness. Tell them about the Torah. Teaching them about the word. He wasn't down there carousing with them. People use that for an excuse. Well, Jesus went to the bar. Yeah, he did. And guess what he did? He told them who he was and what he was there for and how their lives could be changed. That's what he did. I just get a laugh at that. Well, that's to make an excuse so you can stay in your dirty sin. That's keeping you all spotted up and not letting you hear from God like you need to. That's all it's doing. Why don't you do the right thing? Come out of there. Learn and get the word inside you and then get that word out to other people somehow. Show them the love of God. Show them how your life changed, because that's what will change people. A guy came in here one day and he said, I've been watching you for several years. And he said, by watching you, I know you're the real deal. You don't know who's watching you. You don't know who's waiting to see your life. Somebody's watching you, Billy. They're watching you. They want to see how, well, this guy says he knows God. He passed out all those tracks. But is he really who he says he is? Well, they're going to try to find a fault. Now, guess what? They'll find one because we are sometimes faulty, right? But when he sees you just repent and just change, oh, man, I'm not doing that anymore. I got that screwed up. When he sees that in your life and he realizes you have an answer that they don't have to fill that God-shaped hole in their heart, they're going to be coming over to your house. Hey, I want some of what you got. How do you do that? Amen? Amen. I'm gonna start this James chapter 4 because God laid it on my heart, but I don't know how far I'll get. From whence comes wars and fightings among you? Why, this is an age-old question. Why do we have wars? Why do we have fighting amongst us, right? Why do families fight? Pitch themselves against each other. Come they not hence, even of your, back to personal responsibility again, even of your lusts that war in your members? Don't these arguments and these fights start because of you? God didn't make you do that. You chose to do that. You chose not to understand the other person. You chose not to try to work together. You chose to fight each other. Stop blaming stuff on God that's not his fault. He has the truth right here. Where'd it go? There it is. He has the truth right here. Yeah, I'm a Bible thumper. I got a big one. He has the truth right here. You read the instruction manual, you do what it says, and you won't be fighting wars, and you won't be having big problems with each other. But everybody's got to read it. You know? One side reads it, the other side don't. I don't believe in what you believe in. You know what I always say? I believe that you believe what you believe. But Jesus Christ said he's the same yesterday, Hebrews 11. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He does not, even God said, I change not. I don't care if you think that homosexuality is okay today because the times have changed. God said, I change not. That is an abomination. What does abomination mean? It means I don't even want it in my sight. I want it completely away from me. Because you took God's natural process and you tried to turn it into something else. You tried to be God. That's what you did. Man, I love you. If you're in that kind of sin, then I love you. God loves you. But he wants you out of it. And he'll tell you how to get out of it. He'll teach you. He'll show you. I have met so many people that have come out of that. And they say, Mark, I wasn't born this way. I thought I was, but I wasn't. It was me. I decided. This would be easier. This would be the way I could go. Hallelujah. Let's get real in here. Let's get real down here, right? We have to talk about the problems. If a man seems to be religious and doesn't bridle his tongue, but he deceives his own heart, that man's religion is in vain. See, you can talk yourself into anything. You can make excuses for anything, but you follow this word and you won't get off track. You take whatever your new idea is and you compare it with the word of God and what does it say. And you find two or more witnesses, then you can tell me something about it. But you won't. You won't. Because it's the devil right in there saying, did God say It's like in the Garden of Eden when he went up to Eve and he said, did God say that you can't eat of this fruit? Yeah, in fact, and Eve lied. She said, yeah, and even he said we couldn't even touch it. That's not what he said. He said, the day you eat of this fruit, you will surely die. He said, oh, no, you're not going to die. God knows you're going to get all wisdom when you eat this fruit. They died spiritually. No more walking in the garden with God. God came, gave them some clothes, and left, and they did not have a relationship after that. You don't see anywhere in the Bible where it talks about Adam and God having a relationship after that happened. It took him to find Abraham, who would believe him, Noah, who would believe him and do what he said. You lust and you have not. You kill and you desire to have and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet you have not because you ask not. What did it say? Every good gift comes from the Father of lights, right? We read that. You're asking the wrong source. Well, I want that, so I'm going to take it. I'm going to illegally take it and obtain it. You're fighting with God. That's not going to prosper. You ask and receive not because you ask amiss, that you may consume it upon your own lust. You know, my car's getting older, and I wouldn't mind getting a different car. But I mean, if it lasts another 100,000, I'll drive it that far. But I would like to have certain things, right? But I have to put that against, okay, will that fulfill the ministry's needs? Will that make this a good car for traveling, going from here to Florida and going from here to there to represent the ministry? Is that car kind of a car going to do that? Boy, those Corvettes look really sharp. I'm going to give you one of them.
Yeah, right.
Okay. You, if you travel a long distance in those, you're going to be sore as all get up. No, that's not the kind of car I need for this ministry. Right? We need a van. But we got a van. God blessed us with a van. Now we got to work on that, how we're going to use that. Now we're going to modify it. We're going to modify it a little bit. But all I'm trying to say is ask God who gives liberally. Don't steal it. Don't fight for it. Don't have a big deal. Just turn around and ask God. Well, God, they won't give that to me. All right, God, I know you can give it to me. Not what they got, but you give me something else. I'm not going to covet what they got. Bible says I shouldn't do that anyway. I shouldn't be envious of what my neighbor has. Think soberly. Think about what you need. Think about what it will take to reach souls. What's it going to take to preach the gospel to every creature? That's what God's concerned about. Amen? A little quiet in here. Amen? Amen. Lord God, pure religion and undefiled before God the Father. So, it says down here, you ask and receive not. You adulterers, he says. You adulterers and adulteresses, guys and gals, right? Not leaving anybody out. Know you not that friendship of the world is enmity with God? If you're friends of this world, you're an enemy of God. Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. I don't like that idea. You like that idea, being the enemy of God? Anybody in here want to be the enemy of God? Because you're going to lose. Come on, man. Come on, man. You're going to lose if you're the enemy of God. Do you think that the scripture says in vain, the spirit that dwells in us lusts to envy? Do you think that you're not capable of that? That you're not capable of evil? You are, but you have to live in the kingdom of God, and then that will not be activated. But he gives more grace. Wherefore, he says, God resists the proud, but he gives grace unto the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Resist. He doesn't say you have to war with him, you got to fight with him. He says, resist him. I resist that temptation. This girl says she loves me and she wants me to run off with her. And she's beautiful and she's got everything that I ever thought I would need. Resist. And he'll flee. Submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil and he will flee from you. Submit yourself therefore to God. What is it? It's just God. I surrender. I surrender all, I surrender all to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. Let's stop right there. Have you surrendered today? Have you ever said, God, I just give it all to you. I've tried this. I've tried that. I've done. It's not really working. But I want to give my heart to you completely. I want to surrender. Very simple. God provided Jesus to be the perfect sacrifice for all your sin. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. That whosoever will believe on him, believe means trust in, cling to, and rely on Jesus, will have everlasting life. Man, you want to go to heaven? Just believe. Believe that Jesus died for your sins. And when he comes into your heart and mind, he's going to change it. And you're going to want to do the things of God. And all of a sudden, you don't need the Ten Commandments to tell you murder is wrong. It's in your heart. You start heading that way and the Holy Spirit starts convicting you like crazy. No, don't even think about that. Stop it. Hallelujah. Draw nigh to God and he'll draw nigh to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. You can change it. You can come to God. He's given you grace to get this far. He didn't bring us this far to leave us. He didn't teach us to swim to let us drown. He didn't build a home in us just to move away. He didn't build us up to let us down. God's got you. If you're a Christian, things aren't going very good. You really need to see something change. Guess what? God did not build you up to let you down. He's here. All you got to do is ask. You have not because you ask not. Because you're consuming things on your own lust. You got to stop it. You got to turn to God and say, I give you everything. I surrender everything I got. There's nothing more important than you, God. Take my Maserati. I don't think I've ever even seen a Maserati, but I know they're a big fancy car. Take my house. Take whatever's mine. I'm going to surrender to you. And I'm going to preach the gospel to every creature. And I want to do what you tell me to do and go where you tell me to go and say what you want me to say. You do that, brother and sister, you will change. So I'm going to ask you to say a little prayer after me and ask Jesus into your heart. Don't do it because. Just do it because it's in your heart, because it's something you know is right. I'm going to ask you guys to repeat after me what I say. Everybody repeat it. Say, Jesus, I ask you into my heart. I believe that you died for my sin. I believe that you rose from the dead. I believe that you live inside of me. And you live inside of me by the Holy Spirit. Now, Father, I ask that you fill me to overflowing with the Holy Spirit, that I can be equipped to preach the gospel to every creature. I surrender all. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you said that prayer and you meant it, Jesus came into your heart. You probably felt something change. Get a hold of us. Association of Christian Truckers at gmail.com. Let us know what happened. 618-427-3737. Give us a call. I'm telling you, it's the most important decision you ever make in your life. It is so vital to make the change that you've been wanting. I want to thank you all for listening this morning. That came out different than I thought, as always. We'll dig some more into James next week, but man, God's just saying, just give it all to me. Just surrender. Ask me and I'll give it to you. Ask me for wisdom. I'll give it to you liberally. You have not because you ask not, but you're asking for things to consume the wrong things. Don't say, God, give me a fifth of whiskey. That's not going to work. God, give me the wisdom. Let me know what to do in this situation. Thank you, Lord. Bless my family. Bless my car. Bless my crops. Bless everything in my life. That's the right things to ask. Amen?
Amen.
I better stop or I'll go back into it again. We're going to go to the family church in Bradenton, Florida for their service. And we're going to live stream that with Pastor Phil Durstein, who is the president of the board of directors of ACT and a wonderful pastor. They have great praise and worship, if you'll allow it to, and you act just as if you were there. And you raise your hands and you praise the Lord with them, you're going to feel the Holy Spirit in this room. Amen? We'll take the offering when they take the offering. If they have communion, we have communion cups here that we'll give you. For now, Eric, go ahead and hit the lights, and we will have them in.
And I like that we're playing a lot of happy songs this morning, because if you came in here feeling like you're under a cloud, or you've got a shadow following you around, you know how to beat the shadow? You know how you beat the shadow? I used to live with a shadow following me, thinking something's out to get me. And the Lord said, no. Look behind you. It's goodness and it's mercy. How do you beat the shadow? Change the shadow. He's called us friends. He's called us friends. Who am I that you are mindful of me? That you hear me when I call.
Amazing. Who am I that can help me out of my soul?
hit it in your heart this morning.
God Almighty, Lord of glory, you have called me friend. Oh, God Almighty, Lord of glory, you have called.
Says that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Think about it. We wanted nothing to do with him. The Bible says we were once enemies in our minds, hostile to him and his ways. But that didn't stop the Lord. But he knelt down into the dust. He became just like us, came down on our level, and he died for us. And then he rose again, and he took us with him, and he seated us in heavenly places at the right hand of God. And the ones that were once enemies, he said, that one's my friend. Can you hear the Father saying that to you this morning? You who feel maybe unworthy, you who feel maybe dirty, broken, can you hear, see the Lord pointing you out of the crowd and saying, that one's my friend, you're my friend.
I am a friend of God. I am a friend. I am a friend of God. You call me friend.
even as we sing that song and we declare the name of Jesus, there's power and authority in that. If you have still sickness or any bondage on you, the Bible says, in my name, Jesus said these words, in my name, you shall cast out devils. Now, sickness is of the devil. So, you know, many times we're talking to God about our sickness, and he already knows that. How about talking to your sickness about your God? And if you've still got symptoms of that cancer, you speak to that cancer spirit, because that's not God. You say, in the name of Jesus, I renounce you. In the name of Jesus, I command you to withdraw. I am the temple of the living God. Go ahead, lay hands on yourself right now. If you've got any kind of pain or sickness, say, I am the temple of the living God. In the name of Jesus, I command sickness to go. Lord Jesus, you have given your angels charge over me to keep me in all my ways. No plague shall come nigh this dwelling. I am the dwelling place of the living God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, when we were singing that song, I was thinking of Philippians 2, where the Bible says that Jesus willingly laid down his life. They didn't take his life. The Romans didn't take his life. He was fulfilling the plan of the Father. Laying down his life as a perfect sacrifice on the cross, as a sin sacrifice for us, for salvation. And all these songs we've been singing, you know, if you don't have that kind of relationship with God, guess what? You can have. If you're here, God brought you here. Maybe you thought you were just coming here to check this place out. This is a place where you can say yes to Jesus and receive him. The Bible says, as many as receive him. You know, you don't have to come to an altar. You don't have to raise your hand while we're singing "Just As I Am." Millions of people have done it that way. But the Bible says, just believe in your heart that Jesus came as God, as you're to become your Savior. The Bible says, as many as receive him, he gives you the power to become his sons, his daughter. Can you imagine calling the creator of the universe your heavenly Father? You can do that. I tell you what, let's just all lift our hands right now. And Father, if there's anybody here today that's not sure of where they stand with you, Father, as we pray this prayer, Lord, we pray it to say yes to you and to receive you into our lives, into our hearts. Let's just all say, Lord Jesus, I say yes. I receive you. I believe you died on the cross to become my Savior. I invite you into my life. Come into my heart. Change me. Give me a heart of life. Take away my sin. Empower me to follow you from this day forward. Fill me with your spirit of love, joy, peace. Make me a new creation. Now, Lord, in Jesus' name, amen, 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 amen. Can you just smile? He's smiling on you. He's smiling on you. Hallelujah. 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 You know, if you made a decision today for the first time, at the close of the service, come up to the front and tell somebody. I'll have some altar people up here, and I have a book I want to give you. Make sure you have a Bible. I sometimes forget to say that, but I want to give you every opportunity to get strong in the Lord and build a firm foundation. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away. We're making that declaration. But there's something about your name. About your name. One more time. Kings and kingdoms will all pass away. Oh, kings and kingdoms will all pass away. But there's something about Hallelujah. Isn't God good? Come on, take a deep breath. Be filled with more of his spirit and his life. Thank you, Father. Lord, create a larger reservoir in us to receive more of you, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. Find a seat if you can today. And wow, I just, I feel there's a flow here that, you know, all you got to do is step into it. Now, I'm saying that spiritually speaking. Sometimes we talk about there being a river up here. By the way, these two ladies here that are just smiling, I seem to remember these two young women here of God. I'm talking about you. I'm talking about you guys. We're real informal around here. I seem to remember you on the floor here. What, Friday night was it, maybe? And are you friends of Janine? Oh, look out. My goodness. Deborah and Raquel, I got to meet you because your friend, you know, went to the bars with me on Christmas Eve. And we weren't there for those kind of spirits. We were bringing the Holy Spirit. And we covered every bar in town, I think. At least we covered every bar on the island that was open. And I have news for you. The Holy Spirit of God is the real thing. Those spirits are serving in the bars. They're only going to last you maybe for the night. And then you have a hangover in the morning. With Jesus, you know, you're going to be empowered to have a wonderful day in the morning. Hallelujah. Well, listen, I was in the early service. I was just talking about, you know, I've been here long enough now. I think we've had this building now for 50 years. Now, this isn't the first set of carpets we've had in here, but I don't know how many thousands of people have done carpet time on this altar. And I just love it because God puts you on the operating table and he does surgery. Now, this is not with the tools of man. You know, in the early service, we had a young man. I was just talking about the fact that when you get healed, it's not just so you can feel better about yourself. We have a doctor right here. He's one of my doctors right here. Doctor. And God heals you not so you can feel better. He heals you to give you a testimony. It's something the world didn't give to you, and the world can't take it away. It'll be the most authentic sermon you can preach. People don't want to know what church you go to. They don't want to hear about your doctrine. But if you've been healed by the power of a living God on planet Earth today, I'm going to tell you, inquiring minds want to know. And what I'm excited about, church, is not that people are getting healed and getting delivered and set free. I mean, we had a man here 2 years ago sitting back about where Hazel's in the wheelchair and this lady, you're holding your phone, right about where you're sitting. A man that had never been in a full gospel church like this that believes in healing for today. In fact, all his life he was raised up a good little Catholic boy. He's sitting there when he's supposed to be standing in worship. We're worshiping on our feet. The fellow that brought him, you know, been here many times and knows that you stand to worship. Well, he was sitting. He knew when to get up and down in a Catholic church, but not in this culture, right? And so he's sitting there. He had had a stroke a few months earlier, and it had left him a blind eye, totally blind in one eye. He's sitting there. His friend had brought him, and all of a sudden, his eye popped open. I mean, he didn't get called out with the prophetic word. He didn't come to the altar. He wasn't even standing when he was supposed to be standing. And it just popped open, so he starts tapping his friend. And his friend, you know, like us good church folks, he was saying, "Don't bother me. We're worshiping God right now." He said, "No, no, no. My eye open. I can see." And I tell you what, that was the end of it. He brought him up front, you know, and everybody celebrated it. But he's been in the house ever since. And you know what? He's not only kept his healing, but God has blessed him. God has prospered him. You know, do not be satisfied with just getting your healing. He's answering. No, 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 my eye opened, I can see. And I tell you what, that was the end of it. He brought him up front, you know, and everybody celebrated it. But he's been in the house ever since. And you know what? He's not only kept his healing, but God has blessed him. God has prospered him. You know, do not be satisfied with just getting your healing. Do not be satisfied with just asking God to pay your bills and getting your needs met. No, 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 no. God wants you to be about your Father's business. He wants you to be a sign and a wonder. These signs shall follow them that believe. Any believers here? About half of you. We're going to get another altar call. Any believers here? If I can't get you to raise your hand, you know, raising your hand is an act of faith. Making a declaration. Without faith, it's impossible to please God. God is not moved by your need. He hurts for you. But he's moved by your faith. He starts working on behalf of your faith. And so sometimes it's necessary for you to stand, for you to clap. Psalms 47:1, clap your hands, all ye people. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. We're going to become more scriptural around here because I'm teaching you to read your Bible, get more scriptural, because I'm desperate that there is a last days remnant church. Oh, Lance, you're here. I didn't see you're here. Like me, you're going to come to both services, right? Yeah. You're allowed to do that in America. You can even have two Bibles in America. And I just believe that there needs to be a last days remnant church. In fact, I believe we are the Elijah, the spirit of Elijah of today that God is going to use. And I'm going to tell you, people are desperately looking for the reality. Romans 8 says that the whole world is travailing. You know, they're groaning, waiting with earnest expectation. For the sons and daughters. Thank you. most prosperous nation in the world. Well, listen, testing, I'm on. I got to get unconnected here because I need two hands to talk to you. You know what I mean? I'm watching the clock so you don't have to. This is a sausage sermon. I can cut it off anywhere I want. But I'm going to tell you something. I'm probably going to have to get you to the altar at the close or just get you out of your seat just to make a motion from where you're at. Church, I am desperately intent on raising you up to break out of a religious culture and into the culture of the kingdom of God. This message series is intended to keep you from becoming woke Christians, woke with the definition of the world. And I'm going to tread in that area because there comes a time where we got to talk about some of the nonsense that's going on out there so that you don't end up getting sucked into it. Because some people are articulate enough, and the enemy is articulate enough to make anything sound right for that moment. But you and I, we have a book that was written by the creator of the universe. Thank you very much. The God of all creation, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. He left his book so that we could read it. And then he came, paid the price for our sins, died on a cross, went into a grave. I mean, there's a lot of religions in the world, but there's only one that went into a grave that was prophesied hundreds of years in advance that he would. He rose from the grave 3 days later, and someone could say, well, who knows for sure if he rose? Well, he appeared over 500 people before he ascended into heaven. As people, the disciples were watching him, he descended into heaven. And guess what he said? I'll be back. I just woke somebody up. He actually did say he'd be back. Amen. He also said, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel. He didn't say, go build me a church. He said, I will build my church. Thank you very much. But you go into all the world and preach the gospel. But let me tell you what happens here. When we come to church like this, it's the holy huddle. I choose to be holy, set apart. I'm not going to look like the world. I'm not going to talk like the world. My own righteousness is as filthy rags. But greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. It's not by my might, not by my power, but by his spirit, saith the Lord. And the weapons of my warfare, you better watch out. Because I don't play. My big angels around me. Sometimes some of you see my angels. And I love that. I saw them one time, but I don't have time to go there. But let me tell you something. When you come here, I don't want you to feel so comfortable. We're going to have the air conditioning, I think, at the right place. The seats are soft and comfy and all that. And most of the time we get out at around the right time. And that can really cause you to feel comfortable. But you got to understand, every time we walk out that door, we are on a mission. Should we choose to accept it? And just like Jack and Linda Moorhead, your mission might take you to the hospital a lot. But you know what? God is your healer. So while you're in the hospital, why don't you pray for the sick? Lance, it was no accident. You got to pray for a doctor. That doctor said that he didn't want to go under the knife. He's a doctor. And he didn't want to be treated by doctors. So Dr. Jesus put one of you in his path, right in his way, that was bold enough to say, I'd like to lay hands on you. God wants to get his hands on you. And he was healed. I like what happened. You didn't even tell him this. He had pain and he had a bad ear, I guess, a bad ear. And Brother Lance said, well, now I got to ask you, how does it feel? Are you healed? He said, well, it's amazing, he said, but it's about 80 to 90%. And most people would have said, well, that's pretty good. You just go your way rejoicing. You'll be healed later. But no, Lance said, that's not good enough. Let's pray again. Now, that might not be your nature. That's okay. But just remember, when we leave this place, God's putting people in front of you. Sometimes it's angels unawares. And your response to God's assignment on your life is going to determine your miracle. Your response to God's assignment. God can get you here so that you can hear the word of God. Faith comes by hearing the word of God so that you can respond properly. Now, sometimes to get us to do anything, it's like fire. Watch the screen. Yeah, I like that animation that my tech department gave. Because we are carriers of fire. Jeremiah said, his word is in my heart like a fire shut up in my bones. You know, the context of that scripture is Jeremiah looking around him. He had just been beaten up, thrown into prison and ridiculed. And the culture around him, the society around him was really out of order. But he was bringing the word of the Lord. And he was saying, God, they're trying to tell me to be quiet. But I can't because your word is in me like a fire shut up in my bones. I'm going to tell you something. If you hang around here, you're going to catch that fire too. Because we're carriers of the presence of God. This building is not the temple of the Lord. You are the temple of the Lord. So God's inspired me to really ask you to look to God to give you a love, a hunger, desire for this book right here, the book that he left. And we are blessed because in this church, we're not just about the letter of God's word, which is the sword. The Bible says in Ephesians 6, the sword of the Spirit is the word of God, all the armor of God. Just love to handle this. It's just, Sue just has got weight to it too. And it's got a scabbard. You know, I just want to wear it. Yeah. Find some devils to take out. I have had so many experiences in the bars, Janine. You don't know. You've been with me one time, but I've been in every bar in town. And I've had sometimes people get in my face. Now, it's not going to happen to you. But I'm saying that by faith. But people get my faith and try to, you know, say they're going to hurt me. They're going to take me out. And I don't have Patrick with me or he'd help me, right? Wrestling coach and strong guy. But I'm all alone, you know. But you know what I'm thinking to myself? Like Jesus would have said, you can't do anything that my Father in heaven doesn't allow you to do. And if he allows it to do it, then that's his will. But you can't do anything. That's what I'm thinking. I'm not telling him that, but I'm thinking that. And that's the beauty of the Word and the Spirit. Because when Jesus ascended into heaven, he sent his Spirit to the earth. And if you can believe and receive it, then you're empowered by God himself. The creator of the universe lives inside of me. He gives me creative ideas, witty inventions, million-dollar ideas. Yeah. Why not? The earth is the Lord's and everything in it. You know, he gives me peace. You know, when I can't sleep, you know, open the Bible. Boy, that'll put you to sleep. Some of you know what I'm talking about. You read a couple pages, you haven't comprehended a thing. But you know what? This brain is so sophisticated. Just read it anyway and see what God will do. Today, I was going to preach a word about hearing the word. That's information. But we want to go beyond that. We want to know the word. Inspiration is the work of the Holy Spirit. All through the Bible, when it uses the word know, when you look at it in the Hebrew and the Greek, it's like a man and woman knowing each other, being intimate. Joseph didn't know his wife Mary until after Jesus was born, the Bible says. Well, God wants that kind of an intimate, not sexual, of course, but he wants that kind of a close, intimate relationship with him, and then you'll really know him. Guess what? You'll hear his voice. You're that close to God. You can see beyond what your natural eyes can see. And we're going to talk more about that in messages to come. And then we learn how to speak the word. Boy, the devil does not like that. Because you know what? The devil, he can't read your mind. He's not omniscient. God is omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent. The devil is a created being. So he's limited. So you can win the battle in your mind when the enemy comes in. Then like a flood, the Bible says, the Lord causes the word to come forth. And you can say like Jesus, it is written. You don't have to memorize the word because I'm putting it on the screen. I'm delivering it. Sometimes we're repeating it. And that old brain of yours and in your heart, it's cataloging that. It's like making deposits to your spiritual bank account. And when the time comes that you have to make a withdrawal, you don't have to have a memory or be preaching sermons like preachers. It's there for such a time as this. So some of you that have been in the faith for a lot of years, man, you've got a big reservoir. Look out, devil. All we have to do is light it on fire. It's like dynamite. The Bible calls it dunamis, like dynamite. Charisma. It's wonder-working power. Now, the devil has dunamis, too. He's got miracle-working power, but he's missing something. He doesn't have authority. We have authority over the enemy. So we win the battle here, and we start declaring. That's why I said earlier, if you got a need in your body, speak to it, to spirit. Tell your problem about your God, not your God about your problem. He already knows. And then we're going to do the word, demonstrate, demonstration. You can lay hands on the sick and see them recover. I want you to just underline this verse in your Bible, Romans 10:17. Let's read it together. So then, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. That's why I believe that it's just so important to just come to church, or even if you're online, turn it up and listen and let your ears hear and let it deposit something in that super amazing computer, the brain, that even scientists say we only use about 4% of. Well, born again, spirit filled people, they're using more than that. Maybe 10 or 12%, you know. And that's why we're so dangerous to the devil in the world today. Hosea 4:6 says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Here's what's happening in our culture sometimes, is it's easy to just come to church, get a prophetic word from somebody, one of the ministers, one of the leaders, or get hands laid on you, get healed, and then you go home and you never pick up this book. You never develop a personal relationship with God. And so the enemy just keeps taking you out over and over again. That's going to stop. We're going to lay a foundation that you can build upon. And I'm going to promise you one thing. Life is a lot more fun when you get that far in your walk with God. Yes, I'm talking about a quality of life. Not just about going to church, that's religion, that's liturgy. I'm talking about the kingdom of God, a lifestyle with God. This Wednesday night, if you'll come back, I'm going to talk to you about hearing the voice of God. It's in my first book that I wrote. It's one of the benefits of seeking God, pursuing God. Why should God talk to you if you don't have any interest in developing a relationship with Him? If you just have a relationship of hearing from the pastor, getting a word from a prophet, getting hands laid on you by Billy Burke when he comes once a year, you know, that's not a relationship with God. Now, we love all that, and I bring in some of the most anointed teachers and evangelists, pastors, prophets, you know, that are out there, because if I feel they're valuable for you, we're going to bring them here. But I want your relationship to be with Him alone. Because the enemy will try to pick you off when you're alone. But we're going to get knowledge and spirit. We're going to get sword and fire. Say it with me. Sword and fire. Sword and fire. Sword and fire. I just want to pull that out again. Look at this. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching that it would save some that believe. Sometimes it's foolish. And sometimes I go home and I start playing back some of the things I've done in front of you or said. And I go, oh, man, so foolish. Why did I do that? I shouldn't have done that. You know, I mean, preachers, they overthink it, too, sometimes. But while I'm up here, I'm just letting it roll by the Spirit, because I don't want this to just be my commentary or, you know, like a textbook delivery in a university. No, I want to awaken the Spirit of God in you and set you on fire. Somebody say fire.
Fire.
No, not fire. Fire. Some of you do not know my sense of humor, and I got to be careful. Let me just help you understand one thing about this. Faith comes by hearing, but so does fear come by hearing. There's so much information sources in our lives, from social media to the news to people around you. And I'm going to tell you, if we're going to really fine-tune this army of God, we're going to have to get some of those covers on our eyes and our ears and really get plugged into God, because there's a lot more than fake news out there. The enemy will send people in to try to discourage you. I mean, I heard that the Chinese are about to attack America. Now this week, I just heard that, you know. Oh, no, I don't want to cause anybody fear. But, you know, it comes from all directions. And so you got to be careful what you're hearing. You want to hear the Word of God. Get enough of this in front of your eyes as you're reading it on a daily basis. Get plugged into my daily communion. In fact, can you give me a few more minutes here today? Jesus on the road to Emmaus after He was resurrected from the dead. Let's turn to it. Luke chapter 24. I'm going to read you the story, because this is what's scary. Two of His disciples were walking and Jesus shows up and they didn't recognize Him. What's going on with this? 3 years He's been teaching them, you know, and they knew that the tomb was empty. And that's what they were talking about. And Jesus shows up. And He starts chatting with them. And they don't even recognize Him. Wow. I would dare say there's probably a lot of Christians today that go to church but don't have the kind of relationship with Jesus to recognize His voice. That's why you need to come Wednesday night. How God speaks. And how to hear His voice. But here they are, walking, I'm going to pick this up, Luke 24, verse 13. Now, the same day of his resurrection, two of his disciples, I'm reading out of the NIV, were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened that day. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them. But they were kept from recognizing him. How were they kept from recognizing him? Fear, anxiety, disappointment. When you live there, your ears get plugged to hearing his voice. Your eyes are blinded. The Bible says the enemy, the devil, has blinded the eyes of people. That's why they can't come to Jesus. He's blinded them. Jesus asked him, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" He's so coy, you know. They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, he said, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem that you don't know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" Jesus asked. "Engaging conversation, students." "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet." Wrong. "He was the Messiah, Christ, the Christos." You know, this is where they were missing it. Church, this is where we have to have a revelation of Christ. A miracle will do that for you. When you have a manifestation of the power of God in your life, I want every one of you to have that, not just to have a church experience for your faith. Yeah, I believe you can be saved by just believing. But I believe that as you grow, you know, the goal is to grow. If you just have a relationship with the Word, you know, you'll dry up. If you just have the Spirit, you can blow up. You know, if you've got both, you're going to grow up. And growth is the key. So they're telling him about this prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. They just hoped. Hope isn't good enough. You need faith. Look at somebody next to you, say, "You got to have faith." Faith creates substance to your hope, because faith requires the Word of God. But what's more, it's the third day after all this took place. They knew that he had prophesied that he would rise on the third day. "In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body." Well, that should have been a clue. "They came and told us they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see." You know, we can read this and wonder why they weren't believing, but we got to be careful, because it's possible for us too to just have a Sunday go to church relationship with God, and that's religion. But God, he wants you to be about the Father's business and talk to him every day. Read his word every day. Amen, somebody? Amen. Jesus said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ," now he's talking about Messiah now. He didn't call him, did not this prophet, he said, "did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. That's why we have to get into this book. Amen. And they approached the village in which they were going. Jesus acted as though he was going further, but they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it's nearly evening and day is almost over." So he went to stay with them. You know, God is that way. When you get intentional and desperate for him, I mean, it attracts him. He's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him, the Bible says. That was last Wednesday. Get that message if you missed it online. When he was at the table with them, he took bread and gave thanks. He took bread and gave thanks.
I've been doing that online every day, Monday through Saturday, for over 2 years, over 700 times online. And many of you are following me every day doing communion. As soon as he broke bread and gave thanks, gave it to them, their eyes were opened and they recognized him and he disappeared from their sight. And they asked each other, were not our hearts burning within us when he walked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us? I'm putting it up on the screen. Here's what I'm praying for you, church. I'm going to close on this. I realize that roast is in the crock pot. And I know ours is. Thank God it's a crock pot. Here's what I want to do today. I want to declare over you that God is going to put a burning in your heart, a burning of love for the scriptures. I see my dear brother Joe, we've been praying for you. You're in church. Hallelujah. Who's a Gideon? He's our Gideon and a elder here in the church. We have given out thousands of Bibles. I mean, I've had the opportunity to give Bibles in war-torn countries, flying them over. Gideon Bibles, they're not even allowed to do this, but the favor of God, flying them by U.S. helicopters into war-torn countries, boxes of Bibles. And the young men flying the choppers are saying, what's in the boxes? And I'm saying, Bibles. They're saying, what? And Bibles. They say, we're not allowed to fly Bibles. How are you bringing Bibles? They say, I'm well connected. Why are we taking Bibles in? Why are they asking for Bibles in Romania? Why are they asking for Bibles in Syria? We're spoiled. They can't get their hands on a Bible. Because this is God-breathed. The Word of God is God-breathed. We're going to get it off the shelf. And we're going to lay the foundation of our fire and our spirit and life. Amen? Because we've got the fire. We've got the presence. We've got the power of God. But we need that foundation upon which it's got to be built. We got to have both if we want to grow. Amen, somebody? Stand with me. I got to close. Stand with me. I want to ask you to come to the front if you need some fire. If you need God to give you a greater hunger for the Word of God, I want your heart to burn within you when you open the Bible. I want God to open up your ears to hear His voice. If you're hungry for that, you can stand where you are, but if you're really hungry, I want you to come to the altar because you're moving away from the place that you're at, and then we're going to close. I'm not going to take a lot of time with this. This is a decision you're making before God. But I really believe that God put this on my heart, that He said He was going to awaken your spirit, give you a hunger for the Word of God and a fresh awareness of His presence. Father, I'm asking you to open our spiritual ears. Open our spiritual eyes. And Lord, we repent, oh God, for being busy with other things. Lord, for not acknowledging the value, the power of your word. Lord, we want to be able to come against the enemy with it is written. Lord, we need that fire to burn in our hearts, Lord, when we read your scriptures. And I'm asking you, Father, for these. Lord, that you would give us the want to, Lord, to make time to open the book. Lord, direct us, I pray, Father, as to where to read. Maybe some are led to start from the front in the beginning. And just, Lord, to put that word, every scripture, into our heart, into our mind. So today, Lord, I've accomplished what you told me to do. Now I ask you, Lord, to accomplish what only you can do. Put your hand on your heart. Put your hand on your heart right now. Father, we call upon you. We call upon you. Holy Spirit, come. We wake you up, Holy Spirit. Arise. Wake up, O God. Let your fire burn in our hearts, O Lord, with a desire, Lord, to hear from heaven.
Lord, let the scriptures open up understanding and wisdom, Lord, that we've never had before. Father, we thank you for healing. We thank you for deliverance. But we're asking today for relationship. We're asking, Lord, for connection, Lord, that you would give us that intimacy with you. Lord, we want to know you. We want to hear you and we want to know you. Today, Lord, take a deep breath. Be filled with the Holy Ghost. Be filled. Be empowered. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Father, I pray that you will reveal scriptures that will bring direction. Reveal scriptures that will break the yoke. Reveal scriptures, Lord, that need to be declared. Scriptures, Lord, that can be wrapped around our faith, Lord, to give you something to work with. Lord, you watch over your word to perform it in our lives. Lord, I pray those that are watching online too, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus, you know each one of us by name. Lord, those that are hungering and thirsting for righteousness, Lord, let this manifestation today bring new insight to our spirit man in Jesus' name. Let the fire of the Holy Ghost, the fire of your altar, may the fire of your altar never burn. Make me a house. I heard you playing. The fire of my altar never burn out. The fire on my altar never burn out. The fire on my altar never burn out. Make me a house. Say it again. Oh, may the fire on my altar never burn out. The fire on my altar never burn out. Declaring this over you. You are the temple of the living God. Let's say it first person. I am the temple of the living God. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. I have made you my dwelling place. So you will give your angels charge over me. No plague shall come nigh my dwelling. I shall live and not die. I am the head and not the tail. I shall go forth in victory. I am an overcomer. I will get through this problem. I will get promotion when I get through. You have a plan for my life. You are making me an overcomer in the name of Jesus. Pray in the Holy Ghost. Pray in the Spirit. Pray in the Spirit right now. Pray in the Holy Ghost.
right now with your eyes closed, just take a breath. Lord, I just pray the peace of God. Lord, you said your yoke is easy, your burden is light. Come, learn of me, he said. Peace, the comfort of your spirit, Lord. No matter what the circumstances, I pray, Father, be our peace that passes all understanding. The comfort of the Holy Ghost. You are the comforter. Called alongside of us to be a counselor, to be a comforter. Peace. Pray peace in your home. Peace on the job. Peace in the classroom. Peace. The comfort of the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Light and life. I've come that ye might have life. Life more abundantly. You are the light of the world, a city set on a hill that cannot be hid. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In Hebrews 11:6, I'm a rewarder of them that diligently seek me. I'm a rewarder of them that diligently seek me. Hallelujah. Day and night. Day and night, 24/7. Unto me, says the Lord, I am your commander in chief, and I will be your rear guard. I will go before you. I'll make a way. The steps of a good man are ordered by me, says the Lord. Every step that you take, I'll order your steps. Listen. Listen for my still small voice. I'll give you instruction. I'll direct you in the way that you shall go. Times you'll hear a voice behind you saying, this is the way, this is the way, walk ye in it. Know that I love you with an everlasting love. I'll never leave you nor forsake you. You are not alone. I am with you and I will be your God. Be strong, be courageous, for the Lord thy God is with thee. The Lord thy God is with thee. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, I just pray for a quality of life. Lord, each day, Lord, that we would find your fingerprints on something outside of church. We'll see that you are involved in our lives. Give us ears to hear and eyes to see. Lord, that you're involved in our lives, I pray in Jesus' name. Let's thank the Lord. Let's just thank the Lord. Hallelujah, Lord Jesus, mighty God. Mighty God, mighty God, mighty God. Hallelujah. Make me a house of bread. Oh, mighty God. Are you here? All the way in the back. Come on up here. Stephen, could you come up here? Last weekend, our young adults were not here.
Hallelujah. What a great message from Pastor Phil, man. They're praying for people all over that church there, and I want to pray for you. I want you to understand that God is a force. He's a real spirit. Those who worship him in spirit and in truth. Father, I pray for everybody on YouTube right now. I send your word to heal. I send your word to make right what's wrong. The truth will make people free. Father, I just thank you right now for everybody that's in the sound of my voice, that the Holy Spirit goes to them, and he does what he does. He guides, he heals, he comforts, he shows them sin, he shows them God and Jesus. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name, touch them all supernaturally right now in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Well, I tell you, that was beautiful. And I'm so glad you tuned in to the Road Angel Church today here at Exit 68 on I-70, where we have free laundry, parking, showers, coffee for drivers, and food and everything they need, because we love truck drivers. God loves truck drivers. Without a truck driver, you wouldn't have any food in your grocery store within about 3-4 days. Just so you know. So anyway, we love you drivers. Thank you for tuning in. Catch us on Thursday night at 7:30. That's when we have Eric's Bible study. And then on Sunday at 10 a.m., stop right back in here for the Road Angel Church again. And until the next time, this is Pastor Mark saying, roll on with Jesus.